workplace, and of course those who are participating in any AFL-CIO activity, event, or meeting, to abide by this code of conduct. It calls for us to have a designee for the meeting, to receive any concerns or complaints, and our designee for the meeting is AFL-CIO International Director Kathy Feingold, who is sitting here in the front row. So if you see or experience something that may violate the code, please let Kathy know. All right, thank you so much. We are excited for today's program, and I'd like to thank the German Embassy for helping to make this event possible, and a warm welcome to Ambassador Emily Haber, who recently arrived in Washington, I think is 3 months in D.C. now. We look forward to continuing our strong partnership. And a special thank you to Anya Velerschek, the German Embassy Labor Attaché, for helping us organize the event today. Yes, Anya, who we have a great relationship with, our sisters and brothers from the German labor movement. And as someone of German heritage, my last name is Schuler, which means student. And we are all students, I would say, who are learning about this topic on the future of work. And in Germany, you have been pioneers in shaping the future of work. So we are grateful for this opportunity to learn from you and hear about your experiences and your innovations. We've been hearing a lot about the advances that you have made at the collective bargaining table, especially the German auto and metal workers unions who bargained a contract that gave workers the right to a 28-hour work week for up to 2 years at a time. And I don't know about you, but I think that's a pretty inspiring example of how you can take control of the future of work process and really use it to make life better for working people. And I hear all the time, having more control over your schedule and more control over your workday is of paramount importance to working people. So this contract not only sets a high bar for German auto workers, we think it's hopefully going to create a ripple effect, putting shorter work weeks at bargaining tables all across Europe, and then hopefully bringing it closer to us in the United States. That is innovation. That is how we make the future of work a race to the top instead of a dystopic economic future that makes us all powerless and poor. And that is why we are so anxious to have this panel discussion today, so that we can share strategies, learn from your experiences, and turn all of this fear-mongering that we're hearing about into opportunity for working people and growth for the labor movement. Because let's face it, we have a lot coming at us, and change is on the horizon, but we've been here before, haven't we? The labor movement has really been dealing with the future of work for decades, if you think about it. Technology is always advancing. Technology is changing our workplaces, and we are, as workers, always evolving, and as societies evolving. And technology has tremendous potential, we know this, to be positive and to be a helpful tool for society and for working people. It can create new jobs, it can create even whole new sectors that we've never seen or could imagine before. It can make our jobs safer and easier to perform our work. It can make us wealthier as a society and allow us to have more time off. And it can improve the quality of our jobs and make them less backbreaking, make them more interesting, and allow us to really unleash our creativity and our know-how. So without a doubt, technology has enormous potential. But it's how we use the technology that matters. And Rich talks about this all the time, right? The technology itself isn't inherently good or evil. It's how it's used. It can be also negative and destructive if we allow it to be. It could make our jobs worse. It could be used as an excuse to abuse workers or eliminate jobs entirely. So the decisions we make as a society will determine whether technology is used for good and to advance everyone's best interests or not. And the labor movement has adapted to innovation, as I said, over decades and in every sector. As you look back over time, we have embraced change, and in many cases, we have helped lead the change. And that's what we need to do again. We need to be on the front edge of this change now, more than ever, and continue to change and grow and learn. I think that's the word of the day, is learn. So I've been doing a lot of traveling across the country, meeting with anyone I can, foundation people, academics, business folk, government leaders, to talk about the future of work. And I've noticed, there's one thing that I've noticed. What do you think it is? There's no workers in this conversation at the table when we talk about the future of work in this country. Very, very often I see that unions aren't even on their radar. But we're starting to change that. We're seeing it. There's a moment in our country right now, working people are on the rise. They're marching, they are striking, they are demanding a say in their future. And I would say young people especially are embracing unions in huge numbers. You may have seen a Gallup poll recently that unions have reached a 15-year high in popularity. And most interestingly, among people under the age of 35 are the most apt to join a union. So we're refusing to let our voice be lost in this debate, or worse, ignored. We have to have a seat at this table with government, with business, just like Germany does it. And Germany is setting the standard, and I would argue thriving because of it, because of your model. It's inclusive, it's forward-looking, and that's why today's event is so, so important. And we're excited to bring together the two leaders of the U.S. and German labor federations for a robust transatlantic discussion with killer questions. And really, again, to have this deep discussion on the future of work and really the future of workers. And we're excited to listen, to learn, and begin shaping this future where working people will have the bargaining power and the real say in changes in the workplace. But none of this is going to be easy. As they say, nothing worth doing ever is easy. But we can do this if we work together, and we work together globally to win a better future. So now, to set the stage for our discussion, is the German ambassador to the United States, Emily Haber. Ambassador Haber has served in this post since June, the latest stop in a long and distinguished diplomatic career. After earning her PhD, she joined the German Foreign Office in 1982 and has held postings in the former Soviet Union, Russia, and Turkey. She served as State Secretary, overseeing security and migration, and was the first woman to hold posts as political director and state secretary at the Foreign Office. It is a true honor and privilege. Sisters and brothers, please welcome Ambassador Emily Haber.
Thank you, Liz, for your very kind words. And good afternoon, everyone. I'm very happy to be here. Liz has said already a lot about the dramatic changes we are facing, and she mentioned the potential positive and the potential negative impact of these challenges. Actually, the American futurist Martin Ford maintains that up to 75% of the occupations we know today will disappear by the end of the century. We all know that change is ahead. It was an eye-opener for me when I was in California and visited Silicon Valley in August. It's incredible how far digital change has already come, but we don't know yet what the exact impact on labor will be and on how best to adapt. That's why we need discussions like the one today. Now, the future of work has become somewhat an ubiquitous buzzword. Many books and studies and events discuss how artificial intelligence will revolutionize certain industries, how autonomous driving will transform transportation, and how automation might make, at least to a certain extent, human labor obsolete. Yet there are few that focus on the future of co-determination and unions in transforming work environment. You all know that in Germany, employers and unions, we refer to them as social partners, engage in continuous dialogue. They discuss labor issues, they discuss social policy, and they do that based on the shared desire to strengthen both economic performance and to promote employment. Naturally, they differ on some issues, but they are often able to find solutions that are acceptable to both sides and without government intervention. This social partnership, as we call it, has been instrumental in steering the German economy through phases of transition and even crisis. And in light of the possibly dramatic changes ahead, employers and unions are now working together to shape the future of work. One element of this effort is the Commission on the Work of the Future. It brought together experts, academics, practitioners from all sides, and it concluded its work last year in 2017. Reiner Hoffmann, president of the German Confederation of Trade Unions, chaired the commission. Mr. Hoffmann, thank you for joining us today. The commission's final report outlines the idea of a digital social market economy and the path towards it. What I found intriguing is that the report highlights both what the commission members agreed on and where they disagreed. Well, that they would disagree is natural given the complexity of the issue and the diversity of the interests of the stakeholders involved. But everyone agreed on this objective. We need to create a framework for labor that is humane, socially balanced, and sustainable. I'm delighted that the president of the AFL-CIO, I could pronounce it as quickly as you could, because it's a very difficult acronym for someone not as acquainted with it as you are. I'm delighted that you, Mr. President Trumka, and Mr. Hoffmann will discuss today how we can best achieve this objective, how we can learn from each other, and how we can work together. Thank you very much, President Trumka, for hosting today's event. It's now my distinct pleasure to introduce Stephen Heuser, who is sitting in the middle of the panel, our moderator today. He's the founding editor of The Agenda, Politico's online magazine. Recently, he edited the magazine's issue titled The Real Future of Work, so he is ideally placed to moderate our panel discussion. And now, without further ado, Stephen, the floor is yours.
With the surname Heuser, I feel like this is one of the only safe spaces in Washington, D.C. for pronunciation. It's normally a bit of a puzzle. So my job right now is to introduce our two panelists. They're well known to you, but I'll give it a shot anyway. If there's one person who needs no introduction, if there's a definition of the concept that needs no introduction, it's the person to my left in the AFL-CIO building, but I'll give it a shot. Richard Trumka was born in a Pennsylvania coal town, got his first job in the mines in 1968, continued working as a miner through college and law school, and became the youngest ever president of the United Mine Workers. He ascended to the presidency of the AFL-CIO in 2009. And as president, he's not only pushed for workers' rights, but a variety of social justice issues that are tied to workers' rights and changes in society and the economy that surround them. including advocating for immigration reform that extends worker protections to more vulnerable people. In keeping with that sort of spirit of keeping track of social change, he's also established the AFL-CIO Commission on the Future of Work, which is the reason that we're all here. Reiner Hoffmann, President Hoffmann, started his career as an apprentice at a chemical company in Germany, and we discovered over lunch that my great-grandfather, also a chemist in Germany, so we have like a little bit of commonality. He won a scholarship to study economics from the Hans Beckler Foundation, which, for those of us here who aren't familiar with it in the United States, the Hans Beckler Foundation defies exact parallel, but it's a type of a high-level think tank that's essentially like union-sponsored by the German labor movement and engages in a lot of like large-scale social issues. President Hoffmann, over his career, has held a number of leadership roles, both in regional unions and in the Europe-wide labor movement. And currently, he's serving his second term as president of the German Trade Union Confederation, in which capacity he was personally involved in organizing and is co-author of the Beckler Foundation's report on the future of work, which, as we've heard, is rather cheerfully titled, Let's Transform Work, with an exclamation point. Both that report and the commission that President Trumka has convened give us a chance here in this venue to step outside the day-to-day fray of labor politics and take a long look forward at what is really changing the workplace, both in America and overseas, and what role labor can and should be playing in the transformation. So we're gonna have a moderated conversation. I'll try to speak as little as possible and help guide the insights of our two presidents. The conversation will last until about 2 p.m. roughly, just so you understand, and then after that, we'll open the floor to questions, which I assume will be a very interesting part of the dialogue, and we'll have questions for about half an hour until about 3:30. As we open the conversation, I'll play by sort of American baseball rules and get the visitor will get the first at bat. The home team will then get an at bat. And then hopefully we'll have a free-flowing conversation at that point. This is okay.
Yep.
So the opening question I wanted to put is just a very simple one, which is what, and also one that sort of a ball thrown into the air by Ambassador Halber, but what is, when we talk about the future of work, we often talk about automation and robots, and the report focuses heavily on digitization. In fact, this magazine that I published, and the reason I'm here at all, is called The Future of Work, has a robot on the cover of it, so I'm guilty of this as well. But that's not the only transformation we're seeing in the landscape, and I'm interested in both of your insights on this question, which is the central one we're here for. When you look at the future of work, what do you mean by the changes in the workplace, and what are the things that you're most concerned about?
First of all, we discussed it also this morning, I'm a trade unionist since over 30 years, and I can remember very well discussions we had at the late 70s, early 80s about the future of work, ? And we had philosophers as Hannah Arendt, Ralf Dahrendorf, many others. And their forecast was that paid work will have no future. And I remember a title of a magazine in Germany called Der Spiegel in the 70s with a picture of a robot, and the title was Robots Will Make Us Unemployed. This was in the 70s. If I look nowadays to the German labor market, we have the highest employment rate since the German reunification with 42 million employees. So I think the German labor market is quite robust, and we have faced a number of changes in the labor market over the last decades. And the situation which we are facing nowadays are driven by three mega trends, I would say. One is what has been stressed, the technological innovation, we are calling digitalization, but this is not the only driver. There is certainly, as a second driver, we have also identified in our report the ongoing process of globalization, which will change the world of labor, and not only in Germany, but especially in Germany, we are faced with the demographic challenge. On the one hand, we can see that people becoming older, which is a good thing. A little child born 2 years ago has a life expectancy of 100 years. And the birth rate in Germany is still quite low. That means demographic challenges will also have consequences for the future of work or the work of the future. And the perhaps a final remark, which we are convinced as a trade unionist or a trade union movement in Germany and Europe, as well as the discussion showed this morning also in the United States, we should make sure that this debate is not simply focused on, if it comes to technological innovation, what is technically feasible. The core of the debate should be, how can we make work better, focusing on human beings, putting human beings in the center of the debate. If we are successful in doing so, I think then we have a lot of opportunities. There are a number of chances, but as a trade unionist, I'm not naive. I know also there are a number of risks, but the debate we are trying to push forward is making use of the opportunities, because as Liz said, there are many, many opportunities new technologies are offering. There are also opportunities globalization is offering, if we get it right done, if it is really on a fair and an equal basis.
Thanks. President, if I could.
You're good.
Yeah, okay. If I could put a little spin on that ball. We have like a very, it's highly digitized future. And the United States, when you look at how work is changing, one of the most striking things happening right now, obviously, is the changing of the fundamental understanding between employees and employers, the fissuring of the workplace. It has a number of different names. And I'm interested in hearing sort of how you all see that also in the framework of these changes.
First of all, let me thank you and Reiner for participating in this event, and let me thank everybody here for coming to this important conversation. I would just note for the record, there are five people involved in this, and four of them happen to be German, and I happen to be on the outside. I don't know what that means, but I just thought I'd recognize that. You know, we're concerned right now that the changes that are happening and the future of work are being driven by the inequality of income and the inequality of power. There's a power imbalance in this country. And as a result, you see employers that are trying to disguise the employer-employee relationship to escape all forms of liability. So they don't have to provide benefits. They don't have to provide retirement. They don't have to pay Social Security and Medicare and all the other things associated with the employer-employee relationship. We fight that every single day. That's not going to be the determining factor, I think, out into the future. What's going to be the determining factor is how we start to allocate this stuff. Can we right the imbalance of power between employers or corporations and workers in this country? Can we get a government that will begin to partner with us? In Germany, I'm always envious, Reiner, when you talk about the study you did. It was business, labor, and government coming together to say, we have a problem facing us, let's tackle it. In this country, we would have business and the government coming together to say, how do we get rid of these other guys over here called the labor people? And so how do we balance that out? What do we do in the future to change that around? That will be the determining factor. And then how do we make sure that the benefits of technology, artificial intelligence, and robotics are divided equally? If you look at, in the past, in this country, trade unionists, any place we had a bargaining relationship, we approached technology and we accepted it generally. I would call it bargaining acquiescence. We would try to get our fair share of it, make sure it wasn't unhealthy, but we generally accepted technology. That goes all the way back to, you know, the Ford days, when Henry Ford was putting up an assembly line. He kept speeding things up, and we kept trying to make things better for people. So we've always bargained with that. But the question now becomes, so we accept that we get a fair share of technology. What happens in society where there is no mechanism to divide the benefits or allocate the benefits of technology, robotics, artificial intelligence? Where does it go? If it continues to go to the top, we see that as a threat not only to workers and our society, but to democracy itself.
So one of the fundamental questions, you know, at this, the heart of this whole conversation is, what's the appropriate role for labor to play, and what's the appropriate posture, you know, for organized labor toward these changes, right? Is it to the posture of let's transform work is obviously a relatively collaborative one, in part because of the somewhat different structure in Europe, where you can sort of assume that you have a role in sort of transforming it. In the United States, it's somewhat different because the change you're talking about, you know, the contingent workforce or the fissured workplace or the abandonment of these responsibilities is a structural threat to labor itself. And that feels like it might be the first battle that you have to fight in this change to just basically preserve the weight and the status quo.
But it's not just it's not just a threat to us.
Yeah,
it's a threat to society and democracy itself. Yeah. I mean, Harvard just did a study of millennials, and they said, how important is it to live in a democracy? 30% of millennials said it's important to live in a democracy. And at first you say, Jesus, why? And then you think, this is the first generation that's lived their entire lives under the rules of globalization, rules that have been designed for them to lose. They've seen their parents' wages cut, their health care cut, their retirement cut. They've seen their parents lose homes. They can't go to school because it's too costly. They can't find a good job. And so it's not just a threat to us. It's a threat to society. And they've come to grips, like in Germany and much of Europe. They've come to grips with the notion that if you have a societal problem, all three stakeholders in society should come together to address that. We still fight that fight every day because even when we win an election or we become recognized, our employers are still looking to drive a wooden stake in our heart the next day or the day after that. So that fight will continue, not just on behalf of ourselves, but for all workers. And I just want to say this, Steve. MIT also did a study, and MIT said that half the non-union workers out there would vote for a union tomorrow and have a voice on the job if given the opportunity. Why is that? Because workers in this country say two things. The economy's not working for them, and the political system's not working for them. So it's a threat to all of those, and our job, yeah, we fight those, we go after them, and we win more than we lose when it comes to them subcontracting out and seeing they're not our employees and stuff. We win more of those than we lose, but it's such a wasted fight because we could be using that energy, using that collaboration, using that time and those resources to create more efficient products, better way of lives, or sharing it with each other, quite frankly.
So Reiner, have you seen sort of similar move away from the sort of traditional organized labor, and is that a thing that you've been concerned about in the sort of economic dynamics of Germany right now?
Yeah, certainly. Even if in other words, we have a divided labor market insofar that in Germany still 50% or only 50% of the workforce is covered by collective agreements. They have a quite decent job, decent wages, good working conditions, shorter working hours, longer holidays than those without a collective agreement. But here, this is exactly the challenge for us. How we can increase, again, the coverage of collective agreements. And the experiences we made is that, especially after reunification, in the new Länder, in Eastern Germany, employers didn't join any employer organization. So this has weakened the system entirely. But it's very, very specific that in the old Länder, in West Germany, they started with the practice that you can become member of an employer organization without binding to collective agreements, which is nonsense. So this is one of the challenges we are facing, especially if it comes to new jobs in new sectors driven by digitalization, driven by innovation, that we will be able to shape those jobs to transform work, that work will be good work with good working conditions, decent salaries, good working hours, and health and safety workplaces. The second point is that we're experiencing in Germany where we have a good workers' representation at the company level, which is a special system in Germany we are calling co-determination at two levels, at the company level, where we have so-called works councils. And we just had, every 4 years, they have been elected. Every 4 years in 26,000 companies with more than 180,000 works councillors, which is quite a lot. Those are our actors who will be able to shape and to transform work. But these are only 40% of the companies in Germany who has a works council. So what is with the other companies? And here again, the experience is where we have works councils, working conditions are much better, collective bargaining are properly implemented, and even more, they have a word to say in shaping the process of implementation of new technologies. So employers has to sit at the table and to, not only to talk to works councillors, to talk to employees, in order to analyze the challenges, the changes, and then trying then to implement measures to shape work by, for example, further training. Because training education, to our opinion, will be the key to transform work successfully. Because if technological innovation is accelerating so fast, that means then also that competences, qualification has to be renewed much quicker than in the past. And here again, works councillors doing a tremendously good job at the company level, that this will happen. If this will not happen, then again, we will divide our labor market in those who are highly qualified and those who have more or less very low skills and which will not be able to adapt to the future challenges.
So you brought up an interesting topic, right, which is that not only is change happening, but it's some ways like the rate of change, you know, is changing. That things, change is happening more quickly as time goes on. I think that's probably fair to say, and if I, somewhere in that book, it's probably going to say the same thing. If you, thinking about, you know, the situation in the United States, is that something, right now you actually have sort of, there's a little political wind at your back on the apprenticeships issue, maybe, and like the, is that a, do you see that as like a productive sort of point of traction on this problem for the AFL moving forward?
Well, yeah, I mean, talking about apprenticeships is a positive, positive development, but in this country, for a number of years, if you went into an apprenticeship program, you were stigmatized. Hmm. If you didn't go to college, you were looked at as sort of second tier, that you weren't really really that good, or you'd have been gone to college. And so the first thing we have to do is get rid of that stigma. Here's probably the greatest secret in the United States. Other than the military, the U.S. labor movement trains more people every year than any institution out there. Our apprenticeship programs are second to none. And we talk about lifelong learning, but our apprenticeship programs, particularly in the building and construction trades, have been lifelong learning for a number of years. We bring our journey people back in every couple of years. We retrain them. We do things like that. And it gives them a career for life, not just a job, but a career for life. And so the more people that we can get into them and the more flexible we can become with those training programs, the better off we are. We've struck some partnerships with small and mid-sized manufacturers. We partner with a community college, and we can actually go down to, a half a dozen jobs. If that employer needs trained six people, we can actually do that and get them the training that they couldn't do alone. So the talk about apprenticeship program is an exciting thing, and as long as they continue to be certified. Because if they're used as a way to dilute the quality programs that we currently have, then the talk is all bad and it'll be counterproductive. If it's used to upgrade even the programs we currently have, then it'll be a good thing. And it'll be lifelong, and we'll be able to put a lot of people to work and fulfill a lot of needs that right now people say, where am I going to get skilled labor at? Here's the other question, the other thing I want to talk about that. A lot of employers come out and say, we can't find skilled labor. Well, if you offer an engineer, which I'd consider skilled labor, if you offer an engineer a job at $22,000, you probably can't get many engineers. And if you offer a machinist a job at $750, you probably won't get very many good machinists. But if you give them a decent prevailing wage, what the industry is paying, what their brothers and sisters that are skilled are getting, I think you're going to find out there's a lot of skilled people that are willing to go to work out there. So much of it, much of the, quote, shortage of skilled labor is driven by the low wages that employers want to pay for that, quote, skilled labor.
So when you think, when you look ahead and you think about the dizzying array of changes that are possible, right, just automation on the floor, you know, if everything from automation on the floor to, you know, the virtualization of white-collar jobs and things like that, it's, and I'm interested in your experience in this too, and I want to ask Rich first, because when you look ahead, does it seem like the kind of thing that you can stay on top of? Like the bewildering, not just the pace of change, but the enormous range of types of jobs that are going to be affected by just technology. Like, and talk of apprenticeships sounds fantastic, and it seems like a smart way forward. Is it something that it's even possible for the labor movement to stay on top of and at the level and the pace that it needs to be?
Well, I don't think it's optional for us.
Yeah.
I think that's part of what this futures program is that we're doing.
Yeah.
It's to change us so that we can, because we must, get in front of it. And not just run to keep up with it and survive, but to actually help shape that change so that workers get as much benefit from the technology and all the things that are coming as the capital holders do. So our futures program is currently that we started, and we're a little behind Reiner in his program. We've divided our program into four parts. The first part is looking at the economy, where the economy is and where it's going to go to. The second part is where work currently is and where we think it's going to go to. And we've partnered with people like Carnegie Mellon and MIT, who are the leaders in artificial intelligence, robotics, and those type of things. We're partnering with them so we can get in front of that. The third thing is then where our unions are and where we need to be, given where the economy and work's going. And then the fourth part will be where the AFL-CIO is and where it needs to be, given where the other three are going. So we don't look at it as optional. We think if we don't get in front of it, it'll be to the severe disadvantage of workers across the board, both union and non-union workers. So it's imperative that we get in front of it, help manage it, and help all the changes and the benefits from those changes in order to workers. Because as Liz mentioned, I say this all the time, technology is neither good nor bad. It isn't good or evil. It's just a tool. It's how it's employed. And if it's used the right way, it should give us higher wages, less time on the job, so that we can spend more time enjoying our family. If it's used for bad, then more of the work, the benefits will go to the people at the top. Inequality will grow exponentially, and the threats on all of society, including democracy itself, will be magnified.
So, Reiner, you know, as Rich just said, your guys are a little bit further down the line in some of this, the planning process and the analysis. And so when you look at this question of how do you help your members stay on top the dizzying array of, like, potentially highly specialized and constantly changing training and adaptation you need just to adapt, just to stay, you know, keep pace with the rate of change. How have you been dealing with that, or what kind of plans are you laying to, you know, both offer your members, you know, kind of continuing training to keep them abreast, and all, just also offering as an incentive to be part of the movement to people who might not be?
There are two examples I would like to present. Because as Rich also said, and we are very much aware that with technological innovation, with digitalization, there are huge productivity gains. And what does it mean? And who will get the gains? The employers or the employees? And it offers new opportunities, for example, also in relation to your working time. And we had last year in the transport sector an agreement which offers two possibilities. First, to get a pay increase of 6% or a working time reduction of 6 days a year. And the interesting thing was that 50% of those who are concerned opted for a pay increase. But the other 50% have been more favorable in take more leisure time and to opt for the 6 days more free, to have 6 days more leisure time. So what does it mean? Because this was also a learning curve for us, that nowadays, for a number of different reasons, people have quite a variety of interests, which are also related to a certain moment of their career. If you are younger, probably you like to have longer working hours to earn more. Then if you have to take care for your family, for children, for elderly, probably you like to work less. And to give this flexibility, which is also due to the implementation of new technologies, and the employers have been asking always to have more flexibility. But we are saying, okay, this is to some extent understandable, and we are not against per se for a more flexible workplace, so long as this can be used also for the workers to have more time sovereignty, that they can choose. And then I think this could be then a win-win situation where employees can make the experiences that the introduction or the implementation of new technologies can be of advantage also for them. A second important point is, as I mentioned earlier, that training and competences qualification will be the key to shape the process. And here we have made also first agreements over the last years that further training will be implemented at sectorial level based on collective agreement, and that people can then take time off for training measures. The question is, who is paying for it? And who pays for the replacement? And one innovative result based on agreements was to establish funds which are paid by the employers. And how to utilize these funds, this will be, because it can be very specific and different circumstances in different companies, the works councillors are dealing with it and saying, okay, we have 5% of the workforce who can make use of this fund and going for further training and get a replacement for the salary for 6 months, for 3 months, or whatever is needed, but they specify it at the company level based on a collective agreement which is belonging to the entire sector in Germany. So these are two examples where we are trying to deal with it and making advantage for the workforce.
So in the United States, where you don't have that level, you don't have that sort of intricate, you know, network structure of the unions and the government and the companies, all with like reasonably collaborative processes, how do you create space for workers in an environment that they're going to need more training, you know, just to stay current as time goes on?
We start talking about the needs of workers and then go into to people in the whether they're in academia and having them talk about it, having them write about it, have them raise it. We go to politicians, and instead of endorsing parties, we endorse issues. Mm-hmm. We say, here are things we need you to talk about. You should be talking right now, for instance, having a discussion about how we share the benefits of technology. How will that be equally shared, and what will you do when in a position of responsibility to help that become an equal share? So it's driving an international or a national debate and being part of that debate. We're starting to have some success because we're talking with, as I said, people like CMU, Carnegie Mellon, MIT, and different universities to start having that conversation. It's also educating our members. It's giving them a firm base to understand that skills training, skills enhancement is their best friend, and we are the ones that can and do right now provide it for them. It's hit and miss in the general public because they don't, our apprenticeship programs, if you go to school and college, you pay to go to college. If you go to our apprenticeship programs, you get paid to be an apprentice. At a decent wage while you're learning the skills that you need to go forward. When you're a journeyman, when you come in, you're getting paid to learn additional skills to make you more effective. So it's educating our members, creating a national dialogue, and then us having a pretty laser focus on saying that technology and all the progeny that is included in that term can be good or bad. Let's make it good, and it'll only be good if everybody shares in the benefits of it. And when we get that national debate going, we'll win hands down, because the vast majority of Americans believe, one, that the economy's not working for them, and two, the political system isn't working for them. And if they can get that debate going saying, do you think you ought to get a share, or should it all go to the top? I know the answer to the question there.
So we're talking about, you know, huge top-level political issues, massive economic winds blowing one direction or another, but we're also really interested in solutions, right, and coming up with, like, new paradigms and ways to think about it. Are there things that you've seen in your sort of survey of the landscape in the U.S. where that seem like great examples? You know, like either a very local program that's working out really well, a partnership, you know, the sort of union-university partnership, which is, you know, it's like two universes that come together and have some common ideas. Have you seen real examples of specific stuff that you're sort of excited about as pilot programs?
First of all, that's what the program is, our futures campaign, so I'm not going to prejudge everything. Yeah. But if you look at what's happening with unions, the steelworkers, they're pioneers working with individuals right now to pioneer exoskeleton systems to help them do their job easier, to make it safer for them, to make them more productive. Auto workers are looking at different types of cars, everything from driverless cars on down. They're pioneering in that. Our unions have always grasped technology and been on the cutting edge of it. And I know they try to paint us as neophytes because when a piece of technology comes in that's dangerous, we try to make it less dangerous. We try to insulate our members from that kind of harm. And we don't apologize for that. We think that's part of our job, and we're going to continue doing that. However, we've been at the forefront of technology. Look at our building trades, what they're doing with all the different types of clean energy, solar, all the different types of new methodology of building buildings, building roads. They're on the front edge of that, not the back edge, the front edge of that, and we're making sure that the benefits get shared equally. That's what we're trying to transplant into society as general. Because here, Reiner, we only have 12.5% of the workforce is covered by a union contract. We're going to double that and keep growing. We're going to catch up to you before long.
Right, you're sitting here saying only 50%, right, at night. You just like to murmur going through about 50% of this crowd.
Only 50%.
Yeah, it's down from 70, right? So I'd like to throw the same question to you. I mean, you know, at a very granular level, what we have is a situation where someone who's come up as a lathe operator or something is like, you know, now to, you know, basically to fulfill the same role, you've got to be able to sort of run the computer that runs this whole sort of, you know, an entire line. You know, and 10 years from now, what that's really going to mean is running the AI, you know, understanding the AI operation that, like, controls an entire region's worth, you know, and these are different skills, and they're, you know, changing very fast. And what do you see as, like, programs? Have you seen programs? Are you launching things that, you know, you feel represent really smart investments, pilots, good examples of how this could work?
Yeah, for example, one project we are doing with universities, open up universities for further training. This has been rarely done in the past in Germany. And this leads to new forms of cooperation, because the very crucial question for us is, are we able to anticipate nowadays what kind of qualifications will be needed in 5 years' time? Yeah. So, and it's always difficult to make forecasts so long it's concerned to the future. But here we are working then with universities together, with employers together, and identifying areas for further training and to make this very concrete. The other area where we are quite strong is in our apprenticeship system, because this is what people have to know, that this is based not only on a state based apprenticeship system. Social partners are deeply involved. We are sitting together with the employers, with the trade unions, and looking and monitoring continuously more than 600 professions in Germany, in which direction those professions are developing. And some professions probably will disappear in the near future, and new professions will come up. And how do we create a curriculum for those new professions? What does it mean? Because it is a mixture of school training and training on the job. How this is interacting with each other. And here the huge advantage is that practitioners are working on it from the employer side and the trade unions and with so-called Berufsschulen, professional schools for different professions. The criticism was in the past that this took too long to modernize our apprenticeship systems. Nowadays, I think we have accelerated, and the conflict with the employers was in the past, because an apprenticeship in Germany takes 3 years for most of the professions. And the employer have been always argued, 3 years is much too long, try to reduce it down to 2 years. And we said, no, the competences for the future will be even more complex, so you can't do it in less time. We stick to the 3 years, but then looking forward, what kind of modules we can create that they can pick up every couple of years. So this is an ongoing process, and it works in so far that we have a continuous and ongoing exchange, monitoring and forecast what kind of professions or what kind of qualifications will be necessary for the future.
Steve, can I just comment on that? Yeah, you know, your system. Your system, it'll come back on. Your system encourages cooperation among the three parties. Our system here encourages division among the parties. I mean, it's built on adversarial relationships, and as a result, it's honed into the culture. And I want to give you one example. I formed a labor management cooperative program when I was president of mine workers with a coal operator in Alabama. Now, I never think of Alabama as the most progressive place, but this guy was out front, right? And we put together, he and I sat down, spent hours, put together a program, gave it to our people, my people and his people, and they just kicked it out the door because it wasn't their program. And in addition to that, my middle-level managers and his middle-level managers had made their career being adversarial, and they knew they had the skills to be adversarial, but they weren't sure if they had the skills to be cooperative with one another. So he and I locked them up in a room and said, okay, you don't like our program, you come up with your program. And they moaned and groaned, and a couple of days later, they came back with the program. It started working really well. His productivity went up, injuries went down, number of foremen were reduced dramatically, our people were more autonomous, everybody was getting along well, and then I got elected to the Secretary-Treasurer of the AFL-CIO, and I didn't get to go back, but it was a success. But it's a cultural thing. And in your country, the culture is to come together. In this country, the system bores adversarial relationship. And that's a major, major hurdle that we have to overcome in this country if we're going to be able to jointly look at the challenges that come with new technology and all the progeny of it.
I think this is very well described, Rich, that it is based on cooperation. I would add this kind of cooperation, what we are calling social dialogue, more or less, is based on strengths. Is based on strengths, certainly on the trade union side, but surprisingly to hear from a trade unionist, is also based on the strengths of employer organization. Because if I don't have strong employer organizations where I have a decent and a reliable cooperation, and employers who are ready to sign a contract, which is then implemented at company level, then it will not work. So this is a cultural attitude which is built also on trust and responsibility, and that makes a difference, sure. Hmm.
So we're heading into question time. People have questions. There's two microphones. Am I right about this, right? There's two microphones, one in each aisle. So if you have questions, just feel free to stand up now, and you can line up behind a microphone so you can be heard. And while we do this, I'll end this with one quick question for the home team, the game. We're sitting in the middle of Washington. I'd be remiss if I did not ask this question, but do you see any signs in Washington right now at this moment that leaders have their heads in the right place? Are there people particularly talking about this in a way that makes sense, given what you know about what's coming in the future of work?
Here's one of the most encouraging signs I've seen. In the past, as I said earlier, workers think that both the economic system and the political system hasn't worked for them. I think right now, on the Democratic side, they understand that they have to talk and address kitchen table economics. That if they don't have the basis to talk about that and a program to actually improve kitchen table economics, that they are destined to oblivion. And so the fact that they are talking about it, the fact that they're reaching out, the fact that they're looking to make it campaign issue is going to force the Republican side to at least respond in some sort. So, Steve, that's an encouraging sign. The second encouraging sign is that people really are talking about apprenticeships in a different way. And the third and the most important sign is that collective action in this country is really on the rise. You see teachers coming together in non-union states. You see Black Lives Matter. You see the Me Too movement. You see the student movement. You see all kinds of things going on where people are saying the only way we're going to get this done is if we join together and do it ourselves. And so I find that as the most exciting and encouraging thing that, quite frankly, I've seen in my 50 years in the labor movement.
Well, thanks. So let's move on to questions. We have a lot of interested folks in the audience. So I will just start right there with the woman on my right.
Hi. Thank you both very much. My name is Mindy Reiser. I'm a sociologist, and I'm also on the governing board of the DC Labor and Employment Relations Association, a national organization with chapters all over the country. My question is this. Certain occupations, professions, have often been focused on particular gender communities. And I'm wondering how, as we go forward, say the building trades, steel workers, auto workers, are increasingly reaching out to women, people of diverse ethnic groups who may not have been part of these unions, and how these cultures are changing. You mentioned, Mr. Trumka, the differences in different parts of the United States in terms of their orientation to what we might call more progressive values. So where do you think some of your work is going to have to go to make the union structures or the workers' councils more receptive to different voices and enabling them to have leadership positions?
First of all, I'd broaden out the group that you talked about. And I would broaden it out to include young people. Because for a number of years, we in the labor movement would go to young people and would say, come and join us, here's what we have. And they'd say, yeah, you know, you're really nice people and you're really great, but that doesn't work for me. And we go, yeah, we know. But come and join us anyway. So we really have to reach out to them. Liz has done a great job of reaching out to young people. We have young people that are formally involved in our organization right now, in our government structure. So that's doing well. And the proof of that is we organized 262,000 workers last year, and 75% of them were under the age of 35, which is a great sign. The second thing is when you talked about women, about people of color, we do constant outreach to them, not just with, hey, come and join us, because they have joined us. Roughly 50% of our membership are women. A growing percentage of our membership are people of color. And quite frankly, the most loyal group that we have is the African-American community. Without question, they are the most loyal group that we have, not only in the labor movement, but quietly in the progressive movement in the United States. So we not only reach out to them, we're doing different things. After Ferguson, we opened up. I went to Ferguson, and I talked to the groups there to find out, you know, what it was that we needed to do. And we did a race commission in the labor movement. Because when it comes to race, when it comes to advancing women's rights, when it comes to advancing immigrants' rights, it is unacceptable for the labor movement to be in the middle of the pack. We have to be at the tip of the spear. And so we did a race commission in the United States, and we had some very tough conversations among ourselves. It was enlightening, it was rewarding, and it was just the beginning of where we go. It's a constant evolution and a constant addressing of problems. When it came to women, you heard Liz read our policy. We did that policy about 15 or 18 months before the Me Too movement got started, because we saw that we weren't immune to it, that we had a problem as well, and we wanted to take care of it and get at the front of that that parade, not be in the middle of it. As I said, we have to be at the tip of the spear, and we're working very, very hard to do that. We do training programs. We bring in people of color and women into all of our training programs, and then we open up opportunities for them. Our executive council is the most diverse of any organization out there, and we're proud of that, not only because it's the right thing to do, but it's made us better. And it's made us stronger, and it's made us an organization that more effectively speaks for all of our members rather than a little band of members or even a bigger band of members. So we know that we have to evolve. We know that we're not pure. We know that we're not perfect. But as long as we're at the tip of the spear and we're fomenting change, we're going to continue to do that. And that means instituting it into every phase of our operation, from top to bottom, and walking the walk, not just talking the talk.
Thanks. So take, Ryan, do you want
to... Yeah, only a very brief remarks concerning the situation in Germany. I would be happy if we would have the same proportion as you have, Rich, woman in membership. We still have something like 40% of our members are women. But the good thing in Germany is that we have something what we are calling a feminization of work, because the participation rate of women into the labor market has increased over the last 20 years significantly. 20 years ago, only 55-60% of women have been in the labor market active. Nowadays, it's more than 75%, which is some step forward. But the negative thing is still 70% of them are locked into part-time work. And the income or the wage gap between men and women is still huge. Women are earning 30% less than men, than female, than male workers. And also in the occupation are huge differences. But this has been recognized, and we are working on it quite successfully over the last years, especially that on working time issues, we taking much more into consideration what kind of preferences women have in order to shape their working time. And this is also what we are trying to do to work. We have, for example, a law which is will be introduced in January next year, that if you are a part-timer, to get the right to become full-timer. And this is something which is very much important for women, because not to be blocked in a part-time work, that they can ask the employers to go back into a full-time job, and he has to prove if such a job is not available.
You know, I just want to add one thing to my answer. Not only do men make a higher wage than their non-union counterparts, but women, people of color that are in unions, make a much higher wage than their counterparts. And while I'm hesitant to say there is no wage inequality in the labor movement, if there is any, it's very, very small. Women make the same wages as their men counterparts because our contracts mandate that that happens. Our contracts mandate that they get a fair opportunity at every job that comes down the pike. And so the best way to eliminate the things that you talked about, get a union contract. It'll protect you.
All right, take the next question from the right mic.
Yeah, hi, Ben Davis with the United Steelworkers. I think this discussion really helped us clarify the differences between a system where you have social dialogue and a system where you basically don't. And I guess my question is, how can we change that? And is there a role that German employers and German trade unions can play working together with the American trade union movement to help make that happen? Because, you know, in our union, we have a lot of big German companies here. We have ThyssenKrupp and Siemens and Evonik and Continental and others. And when they do apprenticeship, if they do it here, they tend to embrace, unfortunately, the Trump-style apprenticeship proposals, which are employer-only. They're not collectively bargained. They're not based on dialogue. And the unions are frozen out. And it just seems from the conversation we're having here that there's a tremendous opportunity to work together with some of those folks who, in Germany, you know, play by the rules and embrace dialogue, and work with some of the unions here to see if we can do something like that. So, thanks.
If you give me 1 second, actually, we're have pretty limited time, we can stay a little bit over if we need to. But one thing I thought we'd do is maybe take a couple other. We could take a couple questions at a time. So that was a great topic, and I thought we could just let a couple other people ask as well.
Hi, thank you both for being here. My name is Victoria Virasing, and I work at a technology company in Silicon Valley. And my question is, you've talked a lot about the impact of technology and the role in the collaboration, desired collaboration between business, government, and labor. What is the role and responsibility on the part of technology companies and those who are actually creating the technologies? And what would a productive relationship between labor and technology look like?
And I'll take one more question, and then we can.
Jim Schmitz, I work with the UAW organizing program, and my question is somewhat related to Ben's point. We've worked and been educated by our colleagues in IG Metall as we've organized German suppliers and assembly plants. but they're always reminding us, don't think that German companies would rather work without a works council or without some of this social dialogue. And it seems to me there's a couple of trends that I'm wondering what you see for the future. One, there is a anti-union law firm industry, an anti-union industry that has been present in the U.S. for many years, led by law firms, and they are now internationalizing. Littler Mendelssohn has opened a number of offices in Germany, other parts of Europe. So that, to me, is somewhat of an ominous trend, number one. Number two is the outside funding that we saw, for example, at Volkswagen in Chattanooga. We had Americans for Prosperity, a Charles Koch-funded operation, directly involved in the campaign. Billboards, they had a person on the ground, et cetera. And I've seen that there's been, in Germany, some competition for works council elections. I don't know to what extent outside funding could be involved in that. But I guess the big question is, what do you see as the future of this social dialogue and the constraints that employers may decide to start to ignore?
I think this is one of the big challenges, and over the last years, I think we have made some progress, but it's certainly not enough, in the cooperation at several levels. On the company level, which is very much important, it's not only the experiences you made here in the United States. We're making also experiences in Europe and in Germany, for example, with employers like Amazon. They are very difficult to handle this because they don't like social dialogue at all. They don't like to sign agreements with German trade unions. They don't like works council. It's a continuous fight with those companies. And unfortunately, as you said rightly, and the colleague before mentioned it as well, that German companies, big corporations, are doing doing probably well in Germany, but they're behaving badly in other countries, not only in the United States, also in other regions of the world. And this is a challenge which is something which we can only work together on to get them really pushed to accept decent conditions which are accepted in Germany, that they have to behave in a similar way also abroad. And Rich and I had the opportunity, it was 1.5, 2 years ago, under we had the L20, the G20 presidency in Germany, and we addressed a number of those cases, also face-to-face with the German Chancellor Angela Merkel. But don't expect quick solutions. I think we have to make always the point that our expectation as a trade union movement is that companies, big corporations, are behaving in a manner which is comparable with their behavior in the country of origin, this is an ongoing fight, for sure. Secondly, I think which is also coming up, and we have made some experiences, if you see the global supply chains and global production chains, this is something we have made first steps, and here I see enough space for improvements, especially in our global international structures with the global union federations, where we have made some progress, where we have established in some companies not only European works councils, where we have world works councils, but it's also an ongoing fight. And to have exchange of working conditions, payment in those companies, and to push them together for better work and recognition in some cases also of trade unions.
First of all, I really want to thank you for the question, because it's a question that we really ought to be talking about. And I'm going to answer your question by giving you a hypothetical at first so that we can think about it. So let's assume that you have a small community that's thriving, and it has a factory that employs 100 people, and technology comes in and eliminates 90 of them. Now, the community's tax base just got destroyed. The community's schools just got destroyed, and all the money is going to go where? Who's going to get the money from that increase in productivity from going from 100 people to 9 to 10 people? That's the debate that we have to have. And what you have, I think tech companies have as an obligation, is to lead that debate. Your industry is leading where we're going, and you need to lead that debate. You need to help us create opportunities and talk about what's best for all the stakeholders, for that community, for the workers, for the school, for the shareholders as well. Well, how do we reconcile those differences? Because right now in the United States, we don't have a mechanism to reconcile or to talk about that. You know, some people might say, "Oh, yeah, we have the legislature, the House and the Senate." Well, good luck with that one, if you believe that's a solution. You know, so it is the debate that we ought to have. And you ask the most cogent question of our generation. And I think we need to talk about it and have that very conversation. And when we do, all of us win. Technology is not our enemy. Technology can be our friend. I mean, for God's sake, when my grandpaps first went into mine, they had mules and they picked coal out with a pick and they loaded it with a shovel. When I went into a mine, I had this 36-foot long machine that pumped out 10 ton of coal in 20 seconds. And I wasn't breaking my back on it. I was running the machine. So if you'll help us start that conversation, I think everybody wins. And I really want to thank you for raising the question, because it is the most cogent question that we will face in our lifetime.
All right, we'll do another stack of three questions. I'll start on the left side there.
President Trumka and President Hoffmann, my name is Pat Malloy. I was general counsel of the Senate Banking Committee in the mid-80s when I saw the movement from stakeholder to shareholder capitalism. The Business Roundtable used to say that they had a responsibility to their workers, their communities, their employees, their shareholders, and even their country. Now, if you look on the Business Roundtable, their responsibility is to their shareholders. The CEOs have tied their own compensation to their ability to increase shareholder value, hold down wages, outsource jobs, very detrimental to our country. Now, Senator Elizabeth Warren has introduced a new piece of legislation that would require our multinational corporations to get a federal charter, and that you would have to put labor and other interests on that federal charter. Do you guys think that would be a good way for our country to proceed, to have a discussion like that?
That's a good topic, and it also touches on the internationalization question that we were getting at the last one. Okay, to the right there.
Hello, my name is Ryan Keckhurst. I'm the Assistant Director of Organizing for the International Union of Painters and Allied Trades. My question also involves internationalization and globalization. So in the building trades, we're increasingly seeing a lot of general contractors operate on a multinational basis. Most large companies now are multinational. It's very hard to rely on political systems to kind of govern employer relations when they operate all over the globe. So from an organizing perspective, how can the trade union movements across the world kind of collaborate in a more productive manner? Like for Skanska, for example, huge general contractor. We work with them a lot here in the United States, but they increasingly operate in the United States like markedly different than they do in Europe, in Northern Europe particularly. In Sweden, they're about 90% unionized. Here, they're not unionized at all. They treat much of the South of the United States like the global South, where there's worker deaths, complete disregard for employer relations, for rights to organize, et cetera. I know my brothers and sisters of the UAW can also attest to this. How can our two countries kind of operate in a manner of solidarity to where, you know, a German union could assist an American union trying to unionize a German company who is, you know, treating us like kind of the subsidization for their model in Northern Europe?
Okay, and one more question, ma'am.
Hello, my name is Ariane Hegewisch. I'm from the Institute for Women's Policy Research, and we also have a project on women in the future of work, and Liz is on our advisory board, and we're very grateful. My question is on the gender balance, not within companies, but you were saying, which I think is very interesting, that unions have always stepped in front of technology and trying to make it socially productive. So how far has been the issue of increasing gender imbalances, making work-family easier beyond just cutting working hours, making it easier to retrain part of your commissions. For example, we work a lot in the U.S. Most people in getting further education in colleges are women, and a lot of them have kids. They work, they have kids, and they need to study. They don't know what to study. They end up in debt, and they end up in total chaos. So one is, you know, how far can we use technology to make it easier for people to know where to go? How can we use it to enhance childcare? In Germany, the increase in women's participation was through a huge investment in childcare, which is really reinvesting productivity gains. But, you know, how, or making it easier to come into male-dominated occupations. So, thank you.
So those are great questions. How do we use technology and changing workplace to sort of boost the participation and fortunes of women? And then the broad question of internationalization again, where a lot of really big employers cross borders can sort of arbitrage labor standards, and what are models? You know, you guys have done a lot of transatlantic work, I know, and that's part of what this organization is for. What can one side learn from the other, and how do you even confront that kind of situation?
First of all, I think if it comes to internationalization, globalization, we have really to strengthen our international organizations, the Global Union Federations, the ITUC. We have to look much more deeply what the International Labour Organization can do. They have also, as AFL-CIO, as we have introduced such an expert group, they have a group on the future of work, but they don't deal really with the killer questions at the ILO, how to strengthen the ILO under the circumstances of globalization in setting up labor standards which have to be adapted to the new economy, to digitalization. So there are a lot of crucial points which are addressed to our own capacity. And what is also important, how we are able to, it's not so much a case between the United States and Europe probably, but other regions of the world, where we have also the need for capacity building, that labor movements can grow up, and making also sure that, which is an experience, for example, Bangladesh in the textile industry, the tragic accident we had a couple of years ago in a textile company, it is for trade unions always, not any longer at the national level, also at the international level, how we can avoid competition between workers in the United States against workers in Germany, or workers in Germany against workers in India, and vice versa. This is something which is a big challenge for us. I think we have to accelerate. I'm not satisfied. There is much work to do. And the precondition to do something is certainly that we learn from each other what are the differences, what are the common challenges, because even if you have different structures, the challenges are quite the same. One word concerning participation of women in the labor market in Germany. That's right, we have increased facilities for childcare, for example, but it's still a long way to go, and the lack of sufficient facilities is still one of the reasons why women have to work part-time and cannot work full-time, because there is a lack of childcare facilities, or there is a lack also to have schools which offer childcare facilities in the afternoon. This is something we are working on, and progress has still to be made.
To my brother in the painter, just a historical note, I don't know where he got off to, but in 1989, I was president of my workers, and I struck a large coal company in the United States that had operations in Australia and South Africa, who also struck at the very same instant that I did. And I can tell you that had a profound effect on that coal company. We have a group called the ITUC, the International Trade Union Congress. They're the AFL-CIO of the world. Reiner belongs to it. We belong to it from here. And we're trying to work through the ITUC to get more cooperation, more coordination with what we do, from everything from training to economic actions. And then there are things that we do. Take Mexico or Canada. The Mexican worker and the Canadian worker is not my enemy. They're not the enemy of the American worker. There's a model in Mexico. It's a low-wage model. They use a thing called protectionist contracts to keep wages low in Mexico. We were working through with the administration a renegotiation of NAFTA, and we insisted that their wages be able to rise, because when their wages rise, they become consumers of our products. They benefit, we benefit, everybody benefits. So it's up to us to work with our brothers and sisters in other countries to help them. By doing that, we help ourselves. The federal charter, I see you back there. I think it's a great idea because it eliminates the competition among states to try to bid and give goodies to a company, to lure a company from one state to another and spiral downward as opposed to upward. To the other lady that asked about what we're doing, the first thing we're doing different right now when it comes to workers, not just women or people of color, we're actually starting to listen. Before we talked to them and we didn't listen back, now we're actually listening and finding out what you need. And we try to make ourselves into what they need to meet their needs. And so when you have 50% of the workforce that's women and you have 20% of that workforce that are a childbearing age, there are things that are needed. And we're going to fight to make them happen. So we listen to what they need, and we try to meet their needs. And that's the pole star that we try to be guided by.
Okay, so we've hit our official time. There's no penalty at all for standing up right now and heading out. This is the appointed time to leave. However, we have a few more questions, and by my count, we can stack up the remaining questions and probably be done at about 2:40, so that's about the time frame. So if you have to go 2:30, this is the end of the program, and if you'd like to listen to one more set of questions, we can do that. Thanks. Sir.
Okay. My name is Mike Golash. I'm retired from the Amalgamated Transit Union. I used to be president of the local here in D.C. First of all, I'm glad to have this meeting with cooperation between the German and American unions. Because the last time I was here, we had a meeting where we were talking about how the German unions had taken away all of our machine jobs. So I think I'm glad that we've changed our attitude towards each other. It's a progress. You know, I think this thing about cooperation between management and labor really only comes from strong unions. We had an example here in Washington where in 1976, Metro was just opened up. They had all these plans to change everything. We had a strike for 6 days in 1978, and that changed Metro's attitude. They decided to cooperate with us. And for the next 20 or 30 years, we pretty much worked things out. We improved conditions. But the last 10 or 15 years, they began to balkanize the system, bring in more contractors, change the laws, change the arbitration rules. The labor movement in the country has gotten a little bit weaker, and so now they don't want to cooperate anymore. So I think the idea that your cooperation is based on the strength of the labor movement is really an important concept. The second thing is, you know, there used to be an organization, it was called the Third International. It was all around the world. It brought people to the Soviet Union. They trained them to be labor organizers. They sent them back to countries. They helped organize unions, build an international labor movement. I think we need to renew that sort of thinking, create some centers where workers are brought together internationally, trained, and sent back out to help organize an international movement which cooperates rather than worries about fighting each other. Thanks.
Thanks. And a question from the front row.
Okay. Yeah, I'm Norman Birnbaum, a semi-retired professor at Georgetown and decidedly unretired member of the editorial board of The Nation. In the 30s, 40s, 50s, there were very close contacts between the great figures of American thought and the labor movement. Niebuhr, Charles and Mary Beard, John Dewey, the Linz, younger people like C. Wright Mills and Arthur Schlesinger, they were all young then at any rate, thought it absolutely indispensable to their work to keep the closest contact with the American labor movement, which reciprocated to a considerable degree by being interested in them, taking their students on staffs and the like. In the intervening years, the labor interested and labor committed posts in the universities have somewhat retrenched into specialized institutes, specialized chairs. With a younger academic generation, that seems to be changing, and that seems to me to be an exceedingly hopeful sign on the lines of Brother Trumka's remarks on the new composition and energies of the labor movement. Just by way of observation, and in any event, thanks to the panel for a remarkably interesting afternoon.
Well, Professor Birnbaum, thank you. Okay, we'll have two more questions from the...
Great, thanks. Thanks again for holding the conversation. My name's Marcus Courtney, and I serve on the Washington State Commission on the Future of Work, and it's the first statewide commission ever created in the country looking at this topic of the future of work, and it's comprised of labor officials, it's comprised of elected leaders, as well as representatives from the business community. Since you both have been engaged in forming commissions and helping shape outcomes of that, I'm wondering what advice would you offer to me that I can take back to the commission as we begin starting our meetings? And secondly, what are the opportunities that the commission can open a pathway and for dialogue both with the AFL-CIO as well as the work that's getting done in Germany to get also where we could learn and further our efforts in a what's really a social dialogue model that's getting created here in Washington State around this topic? Thank you.
Great. Thanks. And one final question.
Thank you. My name is Victoria Hippe. I'm from Berlin, Germany, where I'm also organized in the German United Service Trade Union. And I'm currently doing an internship here, so thanks for, taking part in this. And I have a question to our American colleagues. I would be interested in the strategy, how you try to tackle the problem of vulnerability of unionists for populist and right-wing positions, which, in my opinion, do not really represent workers' interest in the right way. So this is, I think, a big deal in Europe, and I would be really interested how you deal with it. Thanks.
Okay, thanks very much. We have some really great comments about the potential internationalization of the labor movement and cooperation, about the promising historical trajectory of university cooperation. And then also, what are the learnings, what are the lessons for other organizations looking at the future of work and the labor movement, and the fascinating question of our right-wing populists, sort of swarming in and sort of claiming a lot of the political energy that the labor movement, needs to thrive.
Well, let me start off with the first part that the brother said, you need to have strong unions. All I can say to that is amen. Strength breeds cooperation. Weakness does not breed cooperation or anything else except more capitulation. So you're absolutely right. To the gentleman from Washington, the first thing I tell you to do is set goals. If you have a commission and you say, what are we going to do? Really set some goals of what they are. And then I ask two questions of all of our people. Two questions that I ask are, given that we have an economy that's not working for people and a political system that they believe is not working for them, and artificial intelligence, robotics, et cetera, is going to increase the inequality that we have, what happens when a system cannot or will not provide a rising standard of living to a majority, a growing majority of its people? What happens to the system? Question two, what happens to the benefits of technology? How do we make sure that those benefits are equally and fairly divided in society to all the stakeholders? You have to set goals, give people the resources they need, give them the time to talk together, give them ample time, and don't let the clock determine the outcome, let the outcome determine the clock. in the process. The question about right-wing aggression and taking over, you know, that is probably one of the most complex questions that we deal with in all of our countries, because the rise of the right wing, the far right wing, is happening everywhere. It's been, I think, accelerated in this country when President Trump talked openly about it, and he made it acceptable to talk out loud about it. And so the right wing that normally talked under their breath or behind their hand felt free to take out ads in the paper and carry signs that said everything, or have a giant rally in Charlottesville and things of that sort. That has complicated things with us. What we do is we talk to our members about workplace issues. And I'll give you an example. 10 years ago, the U.S. labor movement was totally divided when it came to immigration. Because our members thought immigration was a threat to them, going to take my job away, and that's the end of it, don't talk to me. Well, we brought in a guy by the name of Ray Marshall, who was formerly the Secretary of Labor, a professor at the University of Texas, an incredible human being, and we had educational sessions with all of our unions. We ended up adopting a totally unanimously supported position on immigration. We found out that those immigrant workers weren't our enemy. And we asked them this question. So you have an employer who has immigrant workers, and he's cheating them out of wages, he's misclassifying them, and he's making them work in unsafe conditions. And he's bidding against your employer for the same work. Who do you think's gonna win? It's not those employees that's your enemy. It's that unscrupulous employer that would exploit those employees in the process. And once they understood that solving that problem was in their best interest, it's sort of, that issue walked away from us as contentious. And so what we try to do is show our members how it's in their best interest to take that issue on. NAFTA, making sure that the Mexican worker gets a fair deal, can negotiate, can get a fair contract, and can increase wages. That benefits every worker in this country, as well as every worker in Mexico. So we try to do that on issue after issue. We're not always 100% successful. I don't know where she went to, but oh, there you are. We're not always 100% successful, but we're more successful than not successful, and we intend to keep accelerating it and pushing it and help our brothers and sisters. Reiner and I talked about this very thing today, how we both jointly address it and how we come together to address that very issue. So we'll keep fighting at it and keep working at it, because they're not going to stop trying. We just have to make sure that they don't succeed, because what they're espousing is quietly caustic and bad for society, not just American society or German society, but civil society itself.
Last word?
Yeah, probably also on the challenge we are facing in Europe, and as Rich said, in the United States as well, how we are dealing with this very far right-wing movements. And we experienced it in Germany over the last 2-3 years, that the so-called alternative for Germany, which is not an alternative at all, is gaining ground, and is gaining ground also that workers are voting for them. And I have really to reflect this, and we made some in-depth analysis. And there was one interesting thing I'd like to share with you, that in cases where workers are covered, sheltered by collective agreements, and working in company with workers' representatives, they voted significantly less for the AfD than others. The consequence for us is that where people have a decent level of security, they are less affected to vote for right-wing parties. And the lesson we should draw from this is that we have to increase coverage of collective bargaining, we have to have decent workers' participation, be able to transform work in the interest of the workers, and that, as Rich said earlier, that the distribution of wealth is much more equal than it has been developed over the last decades. This is one of the common fights we have to fight together as a labor movement in the United States, in Europe, and elsewhere of the world. And therefore, we have also to strengthen our international forces. And this is also the reason why I'm always happy to be here in Washington and in the United States to have exchange with my American friends. We are learning from each other. And out of those processes, we're becoming stronger in facing the challenges also vis-a-vis the right-wing parties, which are a danger, a risk for democracy, and we have to fight and to stay for democracy.
All right, thanks. And these are not simple problems, and they're all quite connected. And like, we appreciate all of you staying here through the end of the time. President Hoffmann, President Trumka, thanks very much for your thoughts. Thank you very much, audience, and I appreciate your input.